little different because I received an email saying that the first half of the talk should be really accessible to graduate students. So I decided to go from the quaternionic setting to the complex setting. So in this complex setting, of course, several things are already known. So part of the talk will be to remind some of the results that already exist. And I will show you still some new results in some geometric context. So the topic of the talk is not exactly either in mixing or in control, but it touches a little bit of both topics. So I found that it was an interesting thing to speak about. So we are going to be interested in simple functionals, which are related to the Brownian motion. So consider a Brownian motion in the complex plane, which is started from zero. So you start from zero and you run a Brownian motion. So this is something that you can see as a limit of two-dimensional random walks. So this is a continuous analog of the two-dimensional random walks in the plane. We are interested in a very basic functional of the path, which is an area which is swept out by zt, that is a moving point zt, up to time t. So I'm looking at algebraic area, meaning that it can take possibly negative values. That is, loops are going to be counted differently, the area within loops, according to the orientation. So the formula for such functional is given simply by the integral of the area form in the complex plane, which is x dy minus y dx, sorry, there was a typo here, along the path of the two-dimensional Brownian motion path. So if the Brownian motion had smooth paths, then you understand that from Stokes' theorem, given the fact that the exterior derivative of x dy minus y dx is 2 times dx dy, you compute exactly the area which is swept out by the path up to time t. So it turns out that Brownian motion paths can be approximated, for instance, in the rough path topology, by smooth paths. So it makes perfect sense, and you get a well-defined object. If you approximate the Brownian motion path by smooth paths, you compute the corresponding area, and you take the limit of the corresponding areas. You are going to get something which is well-defined probabilistically, which is the area which is swept out up to time t by the Brownian motion. And this gives, for those of you who know about stochastic calculus, this gives the Itô stochastic integral. That is, this gives an integral in the Itô sense. So this is the main functional. Yes? So that's a good question. So for instance, you can integrate, you know, harmonic forms against any continuous path. So in that case, continuity of the path is enough. No smoothness is required. However, in this setting, I'm not integrating an harmonic form. So I need some other regularity of the path to make sense of this integral of a smooth form against a 1 half minus epsilon other path. What is that? This is subtle because we have Hölder for a parameter gamma, Hölder which is more than 1/2. It would be the Young's integral. However, Brownian motion path is 1/2 minus epsilon Hölder, and this is why we need actually rough path. That is, we need to go one level higher in the approximation. Yeah. But anyhow, we get by approximation or by directly by Itô calculus an object which is a stochastic area. So this object actually was studied for a very long time by Paul Lévy, even before the notion of stochastic integral was made precise. That is, he had an intuitive notion of stochastic areas, and he was able to compute, in particular, the distribution. So the famous Paul Lévy area formula is a formula that allows you to compute exactly what is the distribution at time t of the area which is swept out up to time t by the two-dimensional Brownian motion. It's even a little bit more precise by this, because you see that the formula gives you a conditional Fourier transform. That is, not only do you know the distribution of ST, but you also know the joint distribution of ST together with the position of the Brownian particle at time t. That is, you know the distribution of the couple, not only the distribution of ST itself. So you have a nice formula given by a very nice function, which is here. And it was proved by Paul Levy even, I told you, before the notion of stochastic integral was made precise. So what he did, he made a Fourier expansion of ZT, that is, of the Brownian motion path, and he computed the Levy area of the Fourier approximations. And he was able to prove, you know, after some harmonic analysis, that there is an equality with the function which is given here. So the formula, which is here, can look to you a little bit complicated, but it's actually a very nice formula which has a connections with a lot of area of mathematics. So there is a connection to rough path theory that I just mentioned before, because in rough path theory, the stochastic area of the Brownian motion plays a fundamental role. Essentially, it says in rough path that if you know how to construct the stochastic area of a path, then actually you know how to construct any integral with respect to this path. So this is a continuity result, which is fundamental in rough path theory. And if you look through the argument, you know, in rough path, the proof and the formula for the Levy area formula appears in some of the arguments. So there is also a connection, which is more unexpected, with analytic number theory, and in particular with the Riemann zeta function. So this connection was uncovered by Mark Yor and Jim Pittman and Philip Bian. This is an exact formula for the Mellin transform of the stochastic area that can be expressed in terms of the zeta function. That is, there is a probabilistic representation of the Riemann zeta function in terms of the Mellin transform of the stochastic area. It's a very simple formula. That is, essentially, the zeta function is the Mellin transform of the stochastic area. So if you want to have some insight and some application to number theory, for instance, you can go to the paper by Pittman, Yor, and Bian. For instance, you'll find an argument, a probabilistic argument, that there exist infinitely many primes which are equal to 1 modulo 4. It has also connections, and I wanted to speak actually a little bit about that, with sub-Riemannian geometry and the heat kernel on the Heisenberg group. Because it turns out that you have a very nice diffusion, which is associated with the stochastic area, which is defined as a three-dimensional diffusion, where you put together the Brownian motion path, ZT, with the stochastic area. So a key insight about this is that the stochastic area itself does not satisfy the Markov property. It's not a Markov process. However, if you had the path of the Brownian motion, then you get a Markov process. This Markov process turns out to be the horizontal Brownian motion on the Heisenberg group. So this is a connection that was uncovered by Gavo in a famous paper in Acta Mathematica, where he explained that the heat kernel on Heisenberg group actually is the probability density of this Markov process XT. So in other words, this Markov process XT is the horizontal Brownian motion on the Heisenberg group. In terms of control, it says that the horizontal Brownian motion on the Heisenberg group is controlled, you know, by its two-dimensional projection on the plane, which is simply a two-dimensional Brownian motion. So the formula of Paul Levy admits many different proofs, okay? So I already told you about the original proof by Paul Levy, which was very ingenious, but which is not the shortest one. There exist many proofs, depending on what aspect of the stochastic area you are interested in. So if you are more interested in sub-Riemannian geometry, for instance, you prefer maybe a PDE proof, which tells you that the stochastic area, the distribution at time t, is a fundamental solution of the heat equation associated to the sub-Laplacian on the Heisenberg group. So there is a purely PDE proof of this theorem, which is due essentially to the observation that the sub-Laplacian on the Heisenberg group is unitarily equivalent to the harmonic oscillator in R2. So using this unitary equivalence, you'll find the formula for the heat kernel on the Heisenberg group. So this is the first proof. There is a proof by Paul Levy. And there is a proof that I like a lot, which is due to Mark Yor, which is a purely probabilistic argument. That is, it only uses probability. It does not use geometry. It does not use PD. And this is an argument which is very robust, because we'll see that we'll be able to generalize it to a much larger framework than stochastic area. So the first observation is that Brownian motion, its distribution, is invariant by the orthogonal group of the plane. That is, you can do a rotation of the Brownian motion, you still get another Brownian motion. So if you are interested in computing such type of conditional expectation, it does not really matter exactly where the point Z is. It just matters on which circle it is due to rotational invariance. So what it means is that the conditional expectation given the position at time t is the same as the conditional expectation given the modulus at time z. So this is the first observation. I do a reduction of the dimension of the problem. That is, I start with a three-dimensional problem. If I apply orthogonal groups, that is, if I apply symmetries to this problem, I reduce the dimension of the problem, and I have now, actually, if you think about it, a two-dimensional problem. So using this invariance, and then using stochastic calculus, especially a theorem that says that stochastic integrals are time-changed Brownian motion, so this is a classical theorem in Itô calculus, so this is related to this Dambis, Dubin, Schwarz, Martingale representation. You'll deduce that this conditional expectation after Martingale representation can be computed in this way. And then the next observation is that there is a very nice change of the probability on the path space of the two-dimensional Brownian motion that is going to transform the process ZT into what is called an Ornstein-Uhlenbeck process and sees Gersanov transforms on the path space of the two-dimensional Brownian motion will reduce the computation of this additive functional of the square of the Brownian motion, which is what we call the two-dimensional Bessel process. That is, it's a diffusion whose generator is a two-dimensional Bessel operator. So it transforms this additive functional of the two-dimensional Bessel process into simply a square of ZT, that is, into the square of a Gaussian process. So if you compare the proof, that is, the proof of the Levy area formula by Yor and the PDE proof, they parallel each other. That is, the fact that the sub-Laplacian on the Heisenberg group is unitary equivalent to the harmonic oscillator is exactly at the heart of the Gersanov transform, which is here. That is, you'll find that the change of probability measures is constructed exactly on the unitary map between Heisenberg group and the L2 space of the harmonic oscillator. So this is an observation which later is important in different frameworks. So my goal will be to explain some natural generalization we can think of of stochastic areas. So after the plane, maybe one of the simplest space on which we can think about a notion of area, which is swept out by a path, is the Riemann sphere, that is CP1, the complex projective space of complex dimension 1, which is the same as S2, that is a two-dimensional sphere. So in that framework, or I will speak directly in the framework of CPN, which is a complex projective space of dimension n, there is going to be a notion of area. Because to construct area of curves, that is area of which is swept out by paths, you know, on a manifold, what you need is an area form. So this area form x dy minus y dx, where does it come from? That is, why is it what we call an area form in the plane? A way to see that is that what I'm speaking about right now is how do we define an area which is swept out by a path on an n-dimensional manifold? By a smooth path. That is it. It's a geometric question. So this is my question that I want to answer now. What are the manifolds for which the notion of area swept by path makes sense? That is, what do we need, you know, to define an area form? Okay, so we need one form with exterior derivative. That is, if you apply the Stokes theorem, give you something that when you integrate on two-dimensional spaces, you get something that looks like an area. That is, what is the structure we need on the manifold to have this notion? So at least a convenient framework is a framework of symplectic manifold, for which you have a canonical two-form. This canonical two-form will define area processes for paths. So if I am on a manifold and I am able to find a one-form whose exterior derivative give you a symplectic form on the manifold, then maybe I have a good notion of area which is swept out by a path. So a very good framework in which symplectic forms are canonical are Keller manifolds. So Keller manifolds are symplectic manifolds, that is, manifolds for which you have an area form, and this area form is intrinsically associated with the distance on the manifold. So this is a perfect framework to have areas swept out by paths on Keller manifolds, because we have a canonical area form, and this area form is intrinsically associated with geodesics, that is, it's intrinsically associated with the distance on the manifold. So I close it. I close it this way by choosing a geodesics between 0 and 1 by geodesics. Yeah, exactly. So what are the simplest examples of Keller manifolds? So if you are in dimension 2, that is in real dimension 2, well, you have, in that case, you know, the complex plane. You have the two-dimensional sphere, and you have hyperbolic space. In higher dimensions, the story is a little bit more complicated because even dimensional spheres, they do not carry Keller structures. So the model spaces in Keller geometry are not the spheres. They are what we call the complex projective spaces. Okay, that is, the analog of spheres are complex projective spaces in this geometry. And we'll see that the analog of hyperbolic spaces are complex hyperbolic spaces. So I'm going to be interested, at least in the first part of this part of the talk, in the case of I'm looking for a Brownian motion in the complex projective space. I'm going to explain you how we construct such object, so don't worry too much about it. And then I'm going to look at the area which is swept out by this Brownian motion on the complex projective space. So I use a lot of words that maybe some of you are not familiar with. So let's go back to the basic. So I'm going to work in CPN. What is CPN? CPN, you can see it as a manifold or as a set of complex lines in CN plus 1. That is, you look at all the lines going through 0 in CN plus 1, you have an n-dimensional manifold, which is called the complex projective space. So CP1, for instance, it's not difficult to see, even geometrically, that is going to be isometric to the two-dimensional real sphere. However, CP2 is not isometric to the four-dimensional sphere. So the isometry between complex projective spaces and Euclidean spheres only hold in dimension 1. So there is a natural way to parameterize line going through 0 in CN plus 1. This is to use inhomogeneous coordinate. That is, you consider the set of coordinates which is given in CN plus 1 by WJ is ZJ over ZN plus 1. In this way, you are able to parameterize all the lines going through 0 but 1, which corresponds to ZN plus 1 is equal to 0, which corresponds to the point at infinity in the complex projective space. So this set of coordinates sees, in a bijective way, all the points in CPN, but for the point at infinity. That corresponds to the line Zn plus 1 is equal to 0. So for us, you know, if we consider probabilistic properties, we need only set of coordinates which are defined almost everywhere. Because we will see that Brownian motion, if you don't start it at the point at infinity, it's never going to visit it. So this is a property of the Brownian motion path. You know that in dimension higher than 2, it does not visit points. It visits any open set, but it does not visit points. Therefore, you know, the probability that Brownian motion sees this point at infinity is 0. So if you have a set of coordinates which is defined almost everywhere, this is perfectly fine for the Brownian motion. So then, how do we construct Brownian motion? So for those of you which are a little bit more geometric oriented, that is, you have in mind, for instance, the case of the Heisenberg group, there is a nice submersion which corresponds to the projection I spoke about, the projection of this three-dimensional path into the plane. So this projection is very famous in physics. This is what is called the Hopf vibration. So there is a Riemannian submersion from the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere into CPN, which is simply given by this inhomogeneous coordinates. That is, if you take a point on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere, which you can see embedded inside of CN, then if you consider this map, what you have is a Riemannian submersion. That is, it's going to preserve the metric. The Riemannian metric of S to n plus 1 is going to induce, in a very nice way, a Riemannian metric on CPN. That is, you are going to project geodesics, for instance. The same will be true for Brownian motion. This submersion, this projection map, is going to transform a Brownian motion on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere into what we call a Brownian motion on CPN. Okay, so this is a perfectly nice way, you know, to construct Brownian motion on CPN, is that you take a Brownian motion on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere, and you project it through this Hopf vibration onto a Brownian motion on the complex projective space CPN. It will not work. There will be a time change. So that's a very good question, actually. If you start from a Brownian motion in CS plus 1, first you can project it on the sphere if you divide, you know, by the modulus. But if you project it on the sphere, you don't get a Brownian motion on the sphere. It's going to be a time changed of a Brownian motion on the sphere. So if you don't want a time change, that is, if you don't want this conformal factor, you need to start from the sphere itself. Yeah. So this is a standard construction of the Brownian motion on CPN to start from the Brownian motion on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere and you project. So you get a Markov process, which is associated with the Laplacian on CPN. Okay, that is from the general picture of diffusion theory. You know, if you have a Markov process, you have an associated generator. And broadly speaking, Brownian motion on a Riemannian manifold is the Markov process, which is associated with the Laplace-Beltrami operator of the manifold. So this construction yields the Markov process, which is associated with the Laplace-Beltrami operator on CPN. So as I told you from the very beginning, CPN is nice. So this is the space I want to work in because I can make a geometric sense of what is the area which is swept out up to time t in that framework. So the formula which is given here, I give it to you as a definition. You integrate a given one form alpha along the path of this Brownian motion on CPN. So what is this one form alpha? Well, you can read the formula for the form, for the one form alpha in C's integrant. That is, this is a formula which is given in inhomogeneous coordinates. This is a one form such that d alpha, that is the exterior derivative of alpha, is almost everywhere equal to the symplectic form of CPN. So there are some computations which are involved here to see that when you integrate this one form and you use Stokes' identity, you get exactly the area form on CPN, which is the symplectic form. So there is a little point that I wish to mention here, is that, you know, on compact Keller manifold, it's a general theorem, that the Keller form is never exact. It's always closed, but it's never exact. However, we don't really need that the one form alpha satisfies d alpha is equal to the Keller form almost everywhere. But we just need that d alpha is equal to the Keller form almost everywhere. We don't need that this is true everywhere. So if I remove one point, which is a point at infinity, which is never visited by the Brownian motion, my formula is perfectly valid. I also put a little bit under the rug that this one form alpha is not unique. Okay, so I choose one which is canonical in inhomogeneous coordinates. But you know, I can reproduce my computations for any form alpha that satisfies d alpha is equal to the Keller form almost everywhere. So it's just going to induce some different in constant, you know, in my computations. So I start from this one that you can take as a definition. So this one is the analog of the Levy area formula in CPN, in my exotic space, CPN. So there is a nice theorem that relates, you know, the stochastic area to the interpretation of Gavo that I spoke about. So I started, you know, with the Brownian motion in the plane. If you add the stochastic area, you have a horizontal Brownian motion in Heisenberg group. So there is a similar fact. That is, if you have a Brownian motion on CPN, you add the stochastic area. What you get, actually, is the horizontal Brownian motion on S to n plus 1. So if you take a process on CPN, you add the area, you get a process, you know, on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere, which is going to be associated with the horizontal Laplacian of the Hopf fibration. So in other words, the situation is exactly identical to the situation of the Heisenberg group. That is, the area process is not a Markov process by itself, but if you add the path, that is the position of the path at time t, then you get a Markov process with a very nice geometric interpretation. Because this Markov process, which is given by this formula, is exactly the process which is associated with a sub-Laplacian on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere. Okay, so this is exactly the parallel with the Heisenberg group situations. So in particular, if I am able to compute the probability density of this path, of this random path, I am able to compute the heat kernel of the sub-Laplacian on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere. Okay? So this is the heat kernel interpretation of the computation I'm going to show you. So this is a very nice theorem. And now I want to apply the proof by Yor that I gave you at the beginning for the Heisenberg group. That is, how do I compute, you know, the probability density of this path that looks very complicated? So the key point will be to perform Gersanov transformation on the path space, paralleling the fact that the sub-Laplacian on S to n plus 1 is going to be unitary equivalent to a harmonic oscillator on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere. So I told you in Heisenberg group, if you start from the sub-Laplacian, you get an operator, you know, self-adjoint operator, which is a sub-Laplacian, which is unitary equivalent to the harmonic oscillator. So here, this is the same. If you start from the sub-Laplacian on S to n plus 1, you have a self-adjoint operator, which is unitary equivalent to a harmonic oscillator on S to n plus 1. So the potential of the harmonic oscillator on 2S plus 1 is the sine square of the distance. Okay, the potential of the harmonic oscillator in Euclidean space is the square of the distance. In the spheres, the potential is the sine square. So if you look at these unitary equivalents, you can guess a Gersanov transform on the path space by using the Yor method. So in particular, there will be two steps in the proof. A first step is a dimension reduction of the problem. That is, I'm going to let an isometric group act on my problem to reduce the dimension. So good for us, CPN is what we call a rank one symmetric space, meaning that the isometric group of the manifold act transitively on the space. So I have a lot of symmetries on CPN. Okay, there is a transitive action of the isometry group. So the law of the Brownian motion is always invariant by isometry. That is, if you apply an isometry to Brownian motion, you get another Brownian motion. So if you apply the action of this group on the law of the Brownian motion, you can reduce the problem, which was 2n plus 1 dimensional, into a two-dimensional problem about a two-dimensional generator. It means that I am looking at the sub-Laplacian on the 2n plus 1 dimensional sphere in radial coordinates, in cylindric coordinates. So there is a formula which is directly given here that follows from some geometric analysis of the sub-Laplacian and the Brownian motion on the sphere. And in particular, the important point that I'm going to start with is the fact that his stochastic area process, as in the Heisenberg group, it turns out that this is a time-changed Brownian motion. So in the Heisenberg group, you know, my stochastic area ST was a time-changed Brownian motion. This is the same situation in the complex projective space. The stochastic area is a time-changed Brownian motion. So just by looking at the proof by Yor and adapting it to this framework, using the ingredients that I told you, which is this unitary equivalence between two operators, we can make the relation between the stochastic area in CPN with the Jacobi heat kernel. That is, there will be a canonical family of operators that are going to integrate this problem, which is associated with the family of Jacobi operators, which, if you are familiar with these special functions, they are related to the radial parts, you know, of the Laplacian on symmetric spaces. So these are diffusion operators which are integrable, that we call integrable in the sense that we are able to compute with them. We know what are the heat kernels. At least there is an expression of the heat kernels in terms of special functions. And there is a formula for the Green functions and so on. So these are integrable systems which are always associated with these families of Jacobi operators. So in particular, you know the formula, that is the analog of the Levy area formula, can be read in terms of these Jacobi functions. So this formula, for instance, implies a formula for the heat kernel associated with the sub-Laplacian. So if you want a PDE interpretation of this probabilistic representation, this is what it is. It's a little bit more precise than the heat kernel formula because it gives a joint conditional distribution of the third component given the first ones. So in particular, there is a nice mixing, okay, I wanted to use this word because of the workshop, which is associated with the process and which is a nice convergence. Okay, that is, if you look at the area which is swept out by time t, by the Brownian motion on the complex projective space, if you divide by t, that is, you take an average in time, you have a convergence when t goes to infinity exactly to the Cauchy distribution of parameter n. So this is a multidimensional Cauchy distribution with parameter n, where n is exactly the dimension of the space. Okay, so this is a very nice result, you know, about the area which is swept out by Brownian motion up to time t. If you take its average in distribution, it converges to a Cauchy distribution with parameter n, where n is the dimension of the space. So it's a very clean result at the end about the long time behavior of the area which is swept out by the Brownian motion on CPN. Okay, so this is a story for CPN. As you can imagine, I don't want to stop here, and I want to understand if there is a general picture, you know, to the theorem I just presented in this specific case of CPN. And before I speak a little bit about that, I want to look at the hyperbolic analog of CPN. Okay, so you know that in Euclidean geometry, that is in Riemannian geometry, there are model spaces, which are Euclidean space, spheres, and hyperbolic space. In Keller geometry, you have complex spaces, complex flat space, complex projective spaces, and complex hyperbolic spaces. Okay, that is, a complex hyperbolic space is not exactly the same as a real hyperbolic space. So I'm going to look at this area construction in the framework of the complex hyperbolic space to see what goes through, you know, and in particular, if there is a limit theorem for the stochastic area, which is swept out by the Brownian motion on CHN. So as a set, CHN is very easy to describe. This is just a unit ball in CN. Of course, you have a metric which is different. The angle, you know, in CHN geometry are going to be the same as Euclidean angle, but the distance is computed differently. That is, you have a distortion of the distance, and in particular, it's a non-compact space. Even though you imagine as a unit ball, you should imagine that you have points whose distance from the origin goes to infinity. Okay, because if you go closer and closer to the boundary, actually, you slow down the motion, and you can never reach the boundary in this geometry. So I want to show you a construction of the complex hyperbolic space, which is the exact analog of Heisenberg group and Hopf fibration. So in that case, the fibration is also very well known from physicists, because this is the anti-De Sitter fibration. So it's a little subtle because the projection that we are going to consider, that is the Riemannian submersion, actually is not Riemannian anymore. It's going to be a semi-Riemannian submersion. That is, you have to start from a Lorentzian metric on a hyperboloid to get the geometry of CHN. So let me just describe broadly, you know, how this construction goes on. So you start from this complex hyperbolic anti-De Sitter space, which is a complex hyperboloid which is embedded in Cn plus 1. So this is an hyperboloid that has signature n minus 1, minus 1. That is, you have two directions in the anti-de-Sitter space that have a sign minus for the metric. Okay. So this is called the anti-de-Sitter space, and this is famous in physics, okay, because these are solutions of Einstein relativity. And there is an associated submersion from C's complex hyperboloid to the complex hyperbolic space CHN, which for me, in this talk, is an open unit ball. So C's submersion is given exactly as it was for the Hopf vibration. You consider inhomogeneous coordinates, Zi divided by Zn plus 1. So this gives a well-defined way to construct Brownian motion on the complex hyperbolic space. You are going to start from a process on the complex hyperboloid, and you project down to a process on the complex hyperbolic space. So if you want to use the language of semi-Riemannian submersion, this is the Riemannian submersions. The fibers, actually, are totally geodesic submanifolds of H1 plus 1. The fibers are isometric to the circle, S1. And you have a very nice projection. So you should think of it as being a projection map. I project down a process. So in this geometry, I also know what is an area. Because the complex hyperbolic space has the complex projective space is a Keller manifold. So I have a symplectic form that allows to compute area form. I know what is area which is swept out by a path. So I give you directly, the formula for the one form in homogeneous coordinates. You should see that it looks really like the one on CPL. The only difference is that I have, instead of a sign plus, I have a sign minus. But essentially, the formula is the same. So for C's form alpha, this one is a little bit nicer than for the form on CPN, because this form alpha, its exterior derivative, is everywhere the Keller form on CHN. So I don't need, this almost everywhere defined. So this one is everywhere defined. So the picture is the following. You have Brownian motion on this complex hyperbolic space. Okay, I told you how to construct it. And you have an area process. So you should believe me that it plays a role of C's quantity that we looked at in the plane. So I would like to tell the same story for this area process as I did in Heisenberg and in CPN. So in particular, I would like to see if this is related to some sub-Riemannian geometry on the top space, which is an anti-de Sitter space. So this is indeed the case. You can construct, you know, a Markov process out of the stochastic area on CHN, which is going to be the horizontal Brownian motion on the anti-de Sitter space. So you have, on this complex hyperboloid, a canonical sub-Riemannian structure, which is the one coming from the structure, the ambient structure in Cn plus 1. So for this sub-Riemannian structure on the anti-de Sitter space, you have a sub-Laplacian. And what I'm telling you is that this process is a Markov process associated with this sub-Laplacian. What is nice is that there is a formula. Okay, so I want to point out this fact again, is that this type of formulas, they provide formulas for the Brownian motion, for the horizontal Brownian motion on these sub-Riemannian spaces. Okay, formula that involve this area which is swept out by path. Okay, so this is how the situation is. And based on this representation, the story follows exactly what was happening in the context of the complex projective spaces. That is, if you apply a group of isometry, because the good news is that CHN as CPN is a rank one symmetric space, and therefore the space of symmetries is extremely large on the manifold. So you can reduce the dimension of your PDE essentially to one-dimensional or two-dimensional PDEs, which are connected again to Jacobi functions. But in that case, they are going to be, instead of trigonometric Jacobi, they are going to be hyperbolic Jacobi functions. And in particular, you know, a worthwhile noting fact is that the area, which is swept out up to time t, is again a Brownian motion, which is time changed. So there is an ergodic theorem, which is going to be associated with this area process. And you observe two things about this ergodic theorem, is that the speed is different first. So it's going to be an almost sure central limit theorem. Okay, so I pointed out in the slide the convergence in distribution, but it's possible to prove that the convergence also holds almost surely. So there is a factor, 1 over square root of t, which is different from the 1 over t that was in the sphere case. And so this is the first thing, the speed is different. This can be understood geometrically by the fact that there is a difference between Brownian motion on compact spaces and Brownian motion on non-compact spaces. Brownian motion on compact space is always going to converge to equilibrium. That is, at the end of time, you have the uniform measure on the space. Okay? If you think of it physically speaking, if you propagate heat, you know, and you wait at infinity, the distribution of heat is uniform. On compact spaces, this is not the same. Okay, that is, you have dissipation of heat, and at the end, you end up at zero. Okay, probabilistically speaking, the Brownian motion on CHN is transient. With probability one, it's actually going to go to infinity. So this is going to affect, of course, the speed at which the area grows. Okay, and if you take this effect into account, you can understand where the factor square root of t comes from. So this is the first observation. The area does not grow in the same rate, you know, in hyperbolic spaces than it does in the spherical spaces. The second observation, which is an observation for which I do not have an extremely satisfying answer, is that the limiting distribution does not depend on the dimension. It's a very surprising fact. So remember that in the case of CPN, you had exactly a Cauchy distribution with parameter n. So n, of course, it was the dimension of the space. That is, a limiting distribution sees how big, dimensionally speaking, the space is. In the hyperbolic space, you forget about the dimension, and the limit theorem is always the same. So this is a universal result. Whatever the dimension of the space is, the limit is going to be the same. It's a normal distribution with mean zero and variance exactly equal to one. So these are the stories for stochastic areas on complex spaces. So these are model spaces in complex geometry. You can play more or less the same goal, the same game in quaternionic geometry. So in that case, it's a little bit more, even more involved, geometrically speaking. That's why I switch finally this talk, you know, from the quaternionic to the complex setting. But we can define quaternionic areas, okay, and we can construct, as we did, and find formulas for processes which are associated with the sub-Laplacian on sub-Riemannian quaternionic space, like the quaternionic Hopf fibration or the quaternionic anti-de Sitter fibration. There is an exact analog of the formulas I told you in the complex case. So just to finish in the last 10 minutes, I would like to speak. Now you can reboot if you want, because this is a part two of the talk, so I'm going to restart from the beginning. You don't need to worry too much about all the geometry I was spoken about. And this is a winding functional. Okay, I told you I'm interested in very simple functional of the path that allow me to understand, you know, how it behaves. One you can think of is the area which is swept out. The other one, if you are in the complex plane, is how it goes around zero. Okay, that is you have a random path. This time, I'm not going to start it from zero. You start from a point, z naught, and you are interested how does it oscillate around zero? How does it wind around zero? So there is a probabilistic random variable that is going to count how the process goes around zero. This is a winding. Okay? So instead of an area form, now we'll get a winding form. So this winding form is given in the complex plane as follows. So is this, in that case, you know, coming back to your question, this form, this winding form is harmonic. So actually, I don't need stochastic calculus to define the integral of this form around the Brownian motion, because I can integrate, you know, from general theory of forms, harmonic forms against any continuous path. So this form is what I'll call the winding form because of this representation. If you have a smooth path in the complex plane, you can look at its radial part, which is its modulus, and you can look at the angular motion. The angular motion is always given by the integral along the path gamma of this one form alpha. Okay, so for every smooth path, we have this representation. So in particular, the integral of alpha along gamma is exactly the angular motion of the path. It explains how my particle zt, you know, winds around zero. Okay? So it's natural because of this representation to call alpha the winding form. And for a probabilist, it's going to be interesting to study the winding process. That is, what happens, you know, when I start instead of gamma with a two-dimensional Brownian motion. How does it go around zero? So this is a very nice story which is associated to it. I cannot tell you all the details, but there have been many, many contributions, you know, around Spitzer, Yor, Le Gall, Bertoin, Werner, and so on. So this is the starting point of a beautiful theory, you know, about the study of two-dimensional Brownian motion. I'm just going to speak about the Spitzer theorem, which is a limit distribution of the windings. Okay, that was a very nice theorem, so which is due to Spitzer in 1958, that says that if you start from a two-dimensional Brownian motion, you look at the angular motion, okay, you have a renormalization by a factor of 2 over log t, and it's going to converge to a Cauchy distribution of parameter 1. Okay, so again, you see the Cauchy distribution appearing as a limit distribution of this angular motion of zt. So what is funny, of course, is the terms, the renormalization speed, which has to be as log t. Also, it's nice to have an exact formula for the limit distribution, which is a Cauchy distribution. So this winding formula was generalized, you know, to the case of CP1 by Henry McKean a little later. So in CP1, there is also a winding form, okay? That is the winding form on CP1. A good way to see it, at least to construct it, is that CP1, it's a fancy name for the Riemann sphere, that is the sphere S2. S2 is stereographically equivalent to C, okay? The C's projection preserves angle. It's a conformal map. That is, windings are going to be preserved by C's conformal map, by the stereographic projection. So if you start from the winding form on the complex plane, you pull it back on the Riemann sphere by using the stereographic projection, you get a nice one form on the Riemann sphere, which is my winding form. Okay, that is, you know how to compute angles, essentially, on two-dimensional spheres using stereographic projection. Okay, so if you do this construction for the Brownian motion, you have a McKean theorem that goes for the windings of the Brownian motion in CP1. So the factor normalization is 1 over T. And in that case, we have a Cauchy distribution with parameter 2. So the 1 over T should not surprise you too much because the space is compact. So you can imagine that Brownian motion is going to win much more than in the complex plane. Okay? Because you go around a fixed point much more often. And the last theorem is about the complex hyperbolic space. The complex hyperbolic space enjoys the same feature. It's conformally equivalent to C. That is, you have a stereographic projection. That is, you have a nice map that preserves angle, you know, between the complex plane and the hyperbolic space. This allows to define what are the winding form. That is, you know how to compute angles, you know, in the hyperbolic space. So you can look at the angle of the Brownian motion, that is the winding process of the Brownian motion in the hyperbolic space. I told you that Brownian motion in hyperbolic space is transient, it's going to go to infinity. Okay? So in particular, the winding is going to be finite. Okay? You're going to have a convergence of the radial motion when t goes to infinity to a Cauchy distribution whose parameter is given by the starting point. So this planes very, very well if you have a Brownian motion on a hyperbolic space. How does this Brownian motion go to infinity? It's going to follow, you know, a direction which is given by this Cauchy distribution with a parameter depending on the initial point of the Brownian motion. So there is an analog story for the Brownian motion on quaternionic spaces. That is, we can explain what is a quaternionic winding. That is, it's going to, instead of counting, you know, an angular motion around zero, you are going to look at a winding form which is valued in the Lie group SU2. Okay, that is what plays the role of S1 in quaternionic geometry is the Lie group SU2. And you can define one forms which are valued in the Lie algebra of SU2 that plays the exact analog of the winding form. So you have nice limit theorems, you know, also in the quaternionic spaces, which are the quaternionic projective space and the quaternionic anti de Sitter space and the quaternionic flat space. All these geometric probabilistic results, what I like about them is that they are all related to sub-Riemannian geometry. That is, they tell you something about the underlying sub-Riemannian geometry of the space. In particular, you know, they give formulas for the diffusions, and they gave some very good insight into the heat kernel of the space. So you can view at this formula from several different points of view, which are all interesting in themselves. So thank you for your attention, and I am done for today.